You know, about a year ago, Silver-Quill and I Love KP a Lot did a second collaboration between them, talking about the villains old and new of MLP, mostly MLP-FIM. Now, the reason they discussed this is because one of the more controversial topics, I guess you could say, that's come out of, or that came out of MLP, even to this day, out of MLP-FIM, was the redemption of Starlight Glimmer. He was a character that at the beginning of Season 5 and at the end of Season 5 was a viable threat. And at the Season 5 finale used time to change things up. Basically messed with time to change things around until she saw what the end result would be in the very end. And that basically, the reason she's doing this is she doesn't want to feel alone anymore, or something like that. Maybe I'm wrong. I have to look at the episode, look at the transcript. But basically, she doesn't want to feel alone anymore. She doesn't want to be without friends. And that it takes a speech from Twilight to say, look, you don't have to do this if you want to make friends or anything. It only takes one friend to help you out. And there you go. And then thus comes Season 6, which is known basically to a lot of fans as mostly the Starlight Redemption season. And yes, Starlight, in turn for this season, has a new hairstyle very similar to Rarity's. So with that said, though, this was the one topic that a lot of fans looked at with mixed reactions. Yes, a lot of fans were happy that Starlight was a new addition to the group. And she was basically, and that they were actually dedicating a season, not most of it, but, well, yeah, most of it, but not all of it, to helping her be a redeemed character, helping her come full circle. But the one other topic and discussion they came up with was the fact that, and this is something that a lot of fans feel is a major problem in MLP. It's a major problem. And that problem is a lot of villains are too easily redeemed. Yeah, a lot of villains are too easily redeemed in the end. It's like there's no real threat from any of the villains whatsoever. There's no real threat whatsoever anymore because they've been redeemed. I guess you could say redeemed villain that still can be villainous a little bit, or a bit of an antagonist, is Discord. But still, even he ends up being redeemed. The point, I think, that Silver-Quill and KP were making, and a lot of fans have also voiced this as well, is there's not a villain or an antagonist or an anti-hero that can be looked at as a real threat. That no matter how hard Twilight or the main six try, she cannot be redeemed. This character, he or she, cannot be redeemed. They cannot change their ways. Now, when they did this co-ab, they presented certain villains that still hold that distinction of being unredeemable. From what's left of King Sombra, to a now powerless Turek, to a now dethroned and impeached queen in Crystalis. So with that said, even though the comic continuation and sequel for Sombra can contract his redemption deal, the writers have said that even though there's continuity nods, there's no real connection. You can get into that as much as you want. Basically, the overall acknowledgement is a lot of the villains, a lot of the antagonists that they have faced, besides these three, and possibly two more, come the movie's release, besides these three, and like I said, possibly two more come the movie's release, just seem to be too unredeemable. Although a lot of fans would agree that Crystalis is probably the closest, is probably going to be the next to be redeemed in the long run. Just saying. But one thing that Silver-Quill brought up was the fact that there is a desperate need for a baddie, or at least an antagonist, anti-hero, whatever, to be a real, to in a sense be a real problem, be a real threat to Twilight and her friends, to the princesses, and possibly to a lot of the characters, ponies and creatures in Equestria overall. And one character he brought up was a character I completely had forgot about. And this shows you how much of a difference, you know, 31 years makes. 31 years ago, I watched, you know, the only reason I watched MLP-G1 was because sometimes there was nothing else on. And I was too young to do anything else at times. Of course, being about, what, 5, 6 years old, that kind of answers the question. Or 6, 7 years old, there's your answer there, I should say. So there really wasn't much for me to do outside, you know, besides going out into the backyard and playing, going out front a little bit. Not really much for me to do at that age. So when Silver-Quill brought up a villain and brought up a potential antagonist, or at least an anti-hero, for the main six to go up against, that could probably be the biggest threat, besides what they'll face in the movie, biggest threat they could ever face, he brought up a character that I completely forgot about. Now, I'd seen this character in, one thing I remember about this character is a lot of the promotional stuff she'd be in. A lot of the promotional stuff. And that's not just because of what I would see when I would go, when I would Google 80s toys and all that on Google, or research 80s toys and all that on Google to see, you know, what toys, trying to remember what kind of toys we had back in the 80s and what kind I had that still get acknowledged and nodded to this very day. But this character would pop up every now and then, and I couldn't remember who this was until Silver-Quill brought up the name of Majesty. Now, one thing he brought up about Majesty is she is a, in G1, she was a kind-hearted pony. Now, I don't know if she was ever in this cartoon series. I think she may have been. I'm not really sure. But she was always portrayed, always seen in books. She was always seen in the storybooks, in the golden books, you name it. The comics, you name it. So, when he brought up Majesty, he brought up one of the things that he feels could make her sort of an antagonist or a pro-antagonist or an anti-hero. And that was the fact that any threat or any villain or enemy, heel, if you will, that she felt needed to be taught a lesson and needed to be punished, she would use her magic from a horn to turn them into whatever she felt was an appropriate punishment. Whether it was a tree or a plant of any kind, bubbles, trap them in paintings, you name it. So, when Silver-Quill brought her up, and he explained maybe the reason why she would be the best choice to be brought in as a rival, as an anti-hero, an antagonist with a good, in her mind, good intentions, a protagonist that does things an antagonist in an antagonistic way. He brought up some good points here. You know, because he would be a character in Majesty that if she was brought into G4, could see characters like he's used in some of his visual aids on DeviantArt that he used in this co-op video. She could be portrayed as a character that would see someone like the Flim Flams, look, find out about them, or do research about them, you know, who they are and what they've done. And instead of just, you know, giving them a threat, a warning of to change their ways, instead she'll just turn them into stone, into statues. Or in the case of if she encounters someone like Starlight, and she knows about what Starlight's done in the past, and even though word goes around that Starlight has been redeemed, Starlight's now a changed pony, Majesty could be so blinded by the fact that she could be blinded by what she had done, by what Starlight had done in the past, that maybe she believes she's not redeemable. She's not redeemable. That all Starlight's really doing is manipulating all the other ponies and creatures, and she's just biding her time. And maybe that's why Majesty takes action on Starlight, and is visually seen in one of the pictures that Silverquill used, turns her into a tree, then sees someone like Discord, knowing about Discord's history, and then hearing that he's been reformed, probably doesn't believe that either, especially since he's the god of chaos. Said, you know what? I don't believe you're totally reformed. I don't see it. Boom, I'm turning you into bubbles. You know, that could be legitimate. That could be, from a character standpoint, a legitimate problem for Twilight and her friends. Because they'd be going up against someone that, in a sense, has a good, that in her mind is doing the right thing. She's doing the justified thing by making sure that all these potential threats, all these so-called redeemed characters, are taken care of. And thus, Equestria is now going to be at peace because this has all been taken care of. And yet, she doesn't see that all she's, that, and that in turn, she doesn't see that by trying to take out the so-called threats and villains and all that, that she's becoming one herself. Because she's so blinded by her disdain for any creature or pony that she feels is a threat or she feels is unredeemable. And story arc and storyline wise, the potential is there. The potential is there for this character to really make an impact in Friendship is Magic, because it could be the kind of character that, you know, strategically plans out how she's going to hit and take care of every problem she sees. And that plans out how she's going to encounter Twilight and her friends. And how she's going to, you know, basically do the same thing of how she's going to face off against Celestria, Cadence, and Luna. Basically, she could be a character, an anti-hero, if you will. The protagonist with antagonistic methods that can always be a step ahead. Always a step ahead of everybody she goes up against. Until finally, in the very end, when there's a bigger threat looming overhead, and she encounters Twilight, and they kind of duke it out, well, this bigger threat is looming overhead, and then they have to put the differences aside to take care of this threat. Only then could you have maybe Majesty see the errors of her ways, but not be a total redemption. Instead, in the end, you could have Majesty restore everybody that she's transformed back to normal, kind of kind of understand and respect where Twilight and her friends are coming from and what their mission is about, and even accept the friendship of Twilight. But in turn, she has to let Twilight and them make her own decisions. They have to let her decide because she wouldn't stay in Ponyville. Instead, she'd go across to Equestria and try to take care of whatever other threats she sees out there. But in turn, by respecting Twilight and her friends for what they do in the end, and possibly accepting the friendship, she would want in return for them to respect her decisions to do what she feels is necessary. And then maybe you could have Twilight and Celestria agree to that, but in the end suggest to Majesty to maybe come up with some other solutions before deciding to go in that direction, before deciding to use her transformation spell to take care of whatever threat she feels is out there. And from a storyline, story arc perspective, that could work. It could really, really work because, one, He would be a character that, even though she wouldn't be fully redeemed at the end of the story arc, at the end of the season, would have a better understanding of why Twilight and her friends are doing what they're doing. But in turn, she'd be the only kind of, not, like I said, not totally redeemed character. She'd be the only one that would still be able to kind of do what she's been doing, but in turn, she'd be giving a little bit of advice. She'd still be doing it, but in turn, she's been given the advice by Twilight and Celestria to come up with other methods, and if nothing else works, do what you got to do. So, honestly, I think Majesty would be a good addition as far as an anti-hero, pro-antagonist, antagonist, whatever you want to call it. I believe she'd be a good addition because she could be a very complex character, believing that what she's doing is right, but in turn not realizing that she's becoming more of a villain than the villain. She's becoming a villain and a threat while she's taking care of what she feels are villains and threats. So the story writes itself. Here would be the question some fans would have. Could the story be done, if she's brought in, and if she becomes a main part of one of the future seasons, if there's seasons beyond season 8, could she be a good plot device? I think if written well, she could be. I really do. I really think she could be written, if she's written well, she could be done. I think she could be a good plot device. She could be a good story device. And in a sense, she could be almost a sympathetic character because, you know, she believes what she's doing is right. Right, and you can kind of understand where she's coming from, but you can also see that maybe there's a part of her that knows what she's doing is wrong, but she feels it's the only justified thing to do. We don't know. I mean, the story is there. And if done right, it could be potentially a very good story arc for a future season, whether it's season 8, season 9, season 10, you name it. But Majesty being brought in, I think, is a great idea. I think Megan, M.A., Jason, Christine, Jessica, I think these people need to really look into that because you have the potential there. The potential is there with this kind of a character. And I don't think anything else has to be said. You know, Silver Quill is white. Right. This could be potentially something that could work. It could really work in the end, especially if you go through with it and at the end of the arc, you have her not be totally redeemed, but have more of a respect and understanding of what Twilight and her friends are doing. And perhaps maybe even accept Twilight's friendship, but in turn have Twilight... and have Twilight, her friends, Celestria, and all them respect her decision as she goes out and about through the rest of Equestria, have them understand and respect her decision to do what she has to do to whatever threats she feels needs to be taken care of. And then, like I said, maybe have Twilight and Celestria give her a bit of advice that... you know, basically have Twilight and Celestia respect that decision, but then give her a bit of advice to try to think of other solutions before possibly having to result to that transformation spell. So it could work in the end. I mean, she's not totally redeemed, but she has a better understanding, and she'd still be willing at the end to have to do what she has to do to protect Equestria. And I think it could really work. I really do. I think it could really work. And let's say they bring her in season 8. Season 9 could be a good season to really follow her, in a sense. Like, you could still do main 6 stories and all that, cutie map stories and all that, but every now and then you could do an episode to where you're following Majesty to wherever she goes. It could really work. It could really work because then in that episode, you could have, by following her, you could see whether or not she makes that decision to do what she has to do. You make to where she either follows the advice she was given or she just flat out goes with the transformation deal. I think I think the potential is there. The money is there as far as stories are concerned. The money is there. This, adding her in, as the old saying goes, would be money for this series. It really would be. Especially if done right. Especially if done right with the way I've thought about it, I've come up with it, and the same way Silver Quill's come up with it. It could be done perfectly. It really could be. So, that's all I'm going to say, folks. I'm about to go get me some dinner. So, let me know what you guys think down below. Comment if you like. But let me know what you think. And I'll talk to y'all later.